My group consists of Steffen Gerke, Michael Brünig and me. I structured my presentation as follows. Firstly, I want to motivate our research, followed by results of UniXL experiments. In the next parts, I want to tell you something about the continuum damage model, the BioXL experiments, the corresponding simulations, and their results. My presentation ends with a conclusion and an outlook. Now, let me start with the motivation. A lot of experiments and numerical simulations for ductile materials have shown that the damage mechanisms are dependent on stress triaxiality. There are two damage mechanisms, the growth of voids, which occurs for high positive stress triaxialities, and microshear cracks, which occurs for moderate negative stress triaxialities. Between these two parts, a mixed form of both damage mechanisms occurs. Furthermore, the idea is that there's a limit for negative stress triaxialities, also called cutoff value, below which no damage occurs and ductile materials don't fail. To investigate this limit is one part of our research. So far, the cutoff value has been assumed to be minus one third. The first experiments to investigate the influence of stress triaxiality were UniXL experiments, which is why I want to discuss some of them. On the right side, you can see a general notch tensor bar. With different notch radii, you get different stress states in the center. The smaller the radius, the higher is the isotropic proportion. On the left side, you can see a tensor bar, which has a central part with notches in two directions. Because of the geometry, the specimen has a shear load in the center and is different from the general tensor bar. For these specimens, the displayed stress triaxialities were achieved. You can see we cover only a small range of stress triaxialities. To get higher and smaller stress triaxialities, we have to perform BioXL experiments. Before going into BioXL experiments, let me show some details about the continuum damage model. We have a phenomenological model, which I want to explain on the basis of a force displacement curve. With the beginning of the load begins the elastic behavior. When a yield condition is reached, a plastic behavior, which is described by a flow rule, occurs in addition to the elastic behavior. In a similar way, when a damage condition is reached, an elastic plastic damage behavior occurs, where a damage rule describes the damage behavior. Furthermore, when a critical damage is reached, macro cracking occurs. In detail, the continuum damage model is based on the introduction of damaged and fictitious undamaged configurations. The model includes a kinematic definition of damaged tensors and damaged strains. In addition, different elastic potential functions are used. And to describe the plastic behavior, we use a yield condition and a flow rule. And in a similar way, for the damage behavior, we use a damage condition and an anisotropic damage rule. Now let me focus on the damage behavior. The damage condition consists of the first invariant of the stress tensor and the second invariant of the stress deviator. The derivation of the damage potential function gives the damage rule. The first part of the damage rule describes the isotropic damage, namely the voids growth. The other two parts describe the anisotropic damage, namely the microshear cracks. These separate parts are controlled by the parameters alpha, beta, and delta, which are stress state dependent with stress triaxiality and load parameter. Now I want to explain the BioXL experiments. Here is our BioXL testing machine, which consists of four separately electromechanically controlled testing cylinders. The specimens are fixed in the center of the machine, how you can see here. And for the evaluation, we use the digital image correlation system, which was above the specimen on the table. That is the biaxial specimen, also called set specimen. It's made of an aluminum alloy and results from the idea of the one-dimensional shear specimen. And it's supplemented by two more arms. Now it's possible to superimpose the shear load with tensile or compression load. The following notation and evaluation points were used for the results. The tensile or compression axis is direction 1, and the shear axis is direction 2. The evaluation points have a distance of 6 millimeters. Now I want to show you the experimental and numerical results. For the numerical simulation, we used the finite element software and this mechanical, and we used the solid elements for the mesh. We performed experiments with 9 different load combinations. The load factor on the shear axis is always 1, and the load factor on the other axis vary from 0 to minus 8 to get negative stress triaxialities. How you can see on the left, the load ratio is kept constant during the experiment. Therefore, the displacements show a nonlinear behavior. Here you can see the force displacement curves of all experiments and numerical simulations in shear direction. You can see that there is a very good agreement between experiments and numerical simulations for all load cases. You can also see that with increasing compression, less forces were achieved and the specimens failed with smaller displacements. Now, I want to show you a short movie of the development of the first principle strain in the experiment with the load factor minus 4. On the right side, you can see a four-step diagram where you can see where we are in the experiment. Okay. Now you can see the strain localizes and the strain band develops from the bottom left to the top right. Maybe again. Yes, you can see the strain band, which indicates early on how the specimen will fail. For a more detailed evaluation, I will confine myself to 3 load cases below, the poor shear test and 2 shear compression combinations with the load factors minus 4 and minus 8. You can see there's again a very good agreement between experiments left and numerical simulations right for all 3 load cases. You can also see that with increasing compression, the strains are more localized and a strain band is developed. Here is the evaluation of the stress triaxiality and loaded parameter of the numerical simulations with a special attention to the fracture surface. In the poor shear test, the stress triaxiality and loaded parameter are in a slightly positive range. And the distribution is very homogeneous. As the compression increases, the distribution becomes less homogeneous, and the stress triaxiality becomes altogether more negative, with the minimum lying in the center. The loaded parameter remains slightly positive in the center, but becomes much larger towards the edge. We also took SEM images of the fracture surfaces in order to take a closer look at the damage. In the poor shear test, in which moderate positive stress triaxialities occur, the mixed damage form can be seen. The voids are visibly, the voids are just as recognizable as the shearing mechanisms. As the compression increases, the voids are visibly more compressed until at the end with the load factor -8, barely any voids are visible. Here are the stressed state results of our experiments and numerical simulations, and you can see that with biaxial experiments you can reach a wider range of stress strike xylities. What does that mean for the cutoff value? In this diagram, our results of the 9 different load combinations are shown with the gray dots. All specimens fractured in our experiments, therefore the cutoff value has to be -0.56 for a loaded parameter nearly zero. In combination with other proposed limits, we want to propose a function for the cutoff value below which no damage occurs and ductile materials don't fail. Finally, I want to summarize my presentation and give a short outlook. I explained the phenomenological model and the stress state dependent damage condition and damage rule. These are the basics for our continuum damage model. On the other hand, I show you the experimental and numerical results. We get strong negative stress triaxialities below -1/3. And we proposed a function for the cutoff value. In the future, work should continue on the development of test specimens in order to possibly achieve even more stress triaxialities. In addition, different ductile metals or the dependence of the loaded parameter and further the cutoff value should be investigated. Likewise, non-proportional load cases could be done, as in the previous talk mentioned. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for your presentation.